What's going on, guys? This is Rob, and we are back with Invincible. Yes, we are. And I told you guys, once you get like full swing into the Viltrumite War, things pop off. And that's exactly what happens here, right? It all starts to go nuts. So one of the things that happens here, really kind of in the beginning, is you've basically got Thaddeus, who calls together really the heads of the coalition of planets, right? Because one of the things to keep in mind, he is kind of the de facto leader, but like a lot of the other races that are part of the coalition have their own empires. It's really more speaking to the other heads, right? So in effect, it's like if Thaddeus was the head of the United Nations, right? And that he's talking to the leaders of the other empires, the leaders of the other worlds or nations that are out there, and just kind of like, okay, so like, here's where we stand at the moment. And this is kind of a big revelation, right? Because the information he gives them here is that the weapons and the arms and armament that they're using are things that have been tracked down, duplicated, so on and so forth, that can basically defeat the Viltrumites. The problem with this is that the linchpin in their plan, right? Mark and Nolan and Oliver, that they're MIA. They're missing in action. They don't know where they are. And that in reality, the entire battle hinges on them being there. So while he doesn't go so far as to say, so long as they're not here, we're fighting a losing battle, that's kind of what's said, right? That's just kind of the message that's communicated. We'll fight valiantly. We'll fight to the bitter end. We'll never retreat, right? That kind of a thing. But in the middle of all this, there's kind of a rumble off in the distance. And then literally, bam, right? Like the Viltrumites arrive on Telestria. Now, that's one of the things to keep in mind. Remember, there's a spy in the ranks of the coalition of planets who's been feeding information to the Viltrumites and has basically set the stage for them to invade Telestria and essentially take out the coalition of worlds at their home. But before we get into that, we end up switching back over to Nolan and Oliver and all them, right? And again, one of the things that had gone on here was Nolan and Oliver had had very much a kind of bonding moment between the two where they had talked about, you know, growing up, and they had talked about life for Oliver on Earth and things like that. And one of the funny things here is because of his split heritage, a lot of the things that we as humans would deem to be beautiful or unattractive, he doesn't really see things the same way. As an example, his mother had taken him, right? Debbie had taken him to a restaurant where he saw a lobster in a tank, and he of course ate the lobster, but he also found the lobster to be beautiful, right? In literally like physical beauty, he found it to be attractive. And so that's when Nolan's like, hey, like I know some girls on Telestria that I can introduce you to. And it's like, really, man? I mean, he's a little young, isn't he? You know, I don't know, maybe he's around 17 or 18 years old, but whatever it is, his dad's trying to get him laid. So ultimately, in the middle of their discussions, there's some kind of rummaging and movement around over at their base camp. And when they get there, they find Mark has basically woken up. Now, here's the funny thing about this. Of course, Mark is basically told, you killed Conquest, right? Like you're the one who destroyed Conquest. And it's kind of a funny thing because Mark talks about how even in this moment now, despite having done it, it's still weird to him because in his mind, Conquest was so incredibly strong, right? I mean, Conquest was probably the single most formidable fighter in the Viltrumite Empire, shy of Thrag. And so the fact that Mark was able to overpower him and ultimately kill him kind of takes Mark by surprise to the point that he actually doesn't really believe that he was able to pull it off. But the response that his father gives him is, here's something that you have to understand. One, you're a lot stronger than you think you are. Living on Earth, the benefit to that is you learn to understand compassion and all that kind of stuff. The downside to that is you've consistently held yourself back. But when you were fighting against Conquest, you had adrenaline, you had rage, you were more invested in the fight than he was. And that's one of the things that Nolan kind of hits on, is that it wasn't just Conquest in this moment. Conquest's entire life has been that way, right? That he basically acts like a spectator in pretty much all of his own fights because he's so incredibly strong, because he's so much further beyond anybody that he's basically fighting. When he ran up against Mark, he just kind of did business as usual and it cost him his life. The biggest problem here though is that Mark's promise that he made to himself is, you know, I wasn't going to kill anymore, right? I didn't want to do that anymore. But the response of Nolan is, this is war, man. This is not the time for you to kind of adhere yourself to these foolish, naive ideologies of we can all live in peace and harmony and all we have to do is sit down and talk to them and everything will be okay. No, it doesn't work that way. There are times when you are going to face an enemy, regardless of what form it takes in your life, where you are not going to be able to reason with them. You're not going to be able to rationalize with them. You're not going to be able to talk to them and get them to understand. The only thing you can do is eliminate them, right? That's the only thing that you can do. The naive perception that every problem in this world can be solved with talking it out. That's not true, right? That was never true. And so what we end up doing is switching back over to Freddie Mercury, right? To Thrag. And one of the things that kind of happens here is a little bit amusing to himself, not a whole lot, but it does give us some insight and motivation into why he's doing what he's doing. The reality is that his motivation, as far as the Viltrumites go, their war against the Coalition of Planets is twofold. The first part is because the Coalition of Planets stands in direct opposition to the Viltrumites themselves, right? It's not as though it's one of these things where it's kind of a live and let live situation. The desire of the Coalition of Planets is to eliminate the Viltrumites, to get rid of their influence from the universe, because the motivation of the Viltrumites is is to conquer everything in existence. Really more the galaxy than the universe, but their goal is to conquer everything. The other motivation for the Viltrumites themselves, and really for Thrag on a personal level, is that prior to him becoming the regent, it was Lord Argal. We talked about that previously when we covered the history of the Viltrumite race. And Lord Argal was killed by the machinations of Thaddeus. And so because of that, it's really more of a personal vendetta to take out Thaddeus and the Coalition of Planets. Now, of course, switching back to Thaddeus and all them, as soon as everything pops off, Thaddeus realizes one of the intel guys was a spy. And he initially goes after the wrong one and then actually goes after the right one. But it doesn't make any difference because suddenly all the Viltrumites basically start arriving on the scene. Now, you do get Alan the Alien, right? You get Tech Jacket, you get these guys who show up, and they're able to offer some measure of resistance and kind of help the Coalition of Planets. But again, the entire conflict is really almost a fool's errand without Nolan and Mark and Oliver, just because of the sheer level of power they possess. It's literally one of those things where just the level of power they have is what turns the tide. And so their arrival signals the turning of the tide here, right? Because as soon as they show up, everything begins to shift, right? It all begins to change. Like literally Mark and Oliver go flying through the command ship of the Viltrumites, which also contains Thrag, right? So that thing, you know, basically starts to crash down to the surface. They end up pushing it out into space, and then Thrag takes off, right? Now, you would expect Thrag to basically jump out, right? To come out here and say, okay, no, that's not going to happen, and to get engaged in this conflict here. But once Thrag gets involved in the fight, here's the thing to understand. Thrag never fights unless he absolutely has to, because he's got the rest of the Viltrumites to fight for him. But when he does, woe betide the poor soul that has to face off against Thrag, because this guy is an absolute monster. That you basically end up having the Viltrumites who just take off, right? They're gone, right? As soon as Thrag leaves, they leave with him. Of course, the spy is basically executed by his partner, more or less. But before he dies, he's kind of like, you know, like this, like we're all, like everybody's screwed, right? Like this, all you guys, it's all screwed. You guys didn't win here, right? I mean, you guys have not had a victory here. That's not what's going on here, right? The idea of the Viltrumites was if this campaign went south, they would regather in their home planet, right? They would regather on their home world. They would marshal all their forces. So every single Viltrumite scattered around all of creation will be recalled, and then they'll launch a final assault, right? They'll launch like this massive attack. And that's a big thing, because what you end up having is, again, Thaddeus calling together what is essentially the Coalition of Worlds, and he kind of declares the Viltrumite War is over, but not really, right? It's not really all that over, but in some ways it is. The reason why is that with the Viltrumites basically all being recalled and then going back to their home world, all the various races out there that have been conquered by the Viltrumites are effectively liberated. And a lot of it is really more of an ideological perspective, because they see that with the Coalition of Worlds being successful in driving the Viltrumites back from Telestria and forcing them back into their home world, that they're basically stronger than the Viltrumite race, right? So in that way, it seems like they don't really have much to fear. And so that's why a lot of those forces that fought on the side of the Viltrumites are now turncoating. They're leaving the Viltrumite cause, even though it was only one done under subservience, and now they're joining the Coalition of Planets and going forward accordingly. The problem with this is most of those guys, if they took them to Viltrumite, they would get slaughtered, right? They would get absolutely crushed. And so the response of Thaddeus is, we need basically a hard-hitting crew, right? The heaviest hitters we have, we need you guys. And so ultimately, Alan the Alien, Mark, Nolan, Tech Jacket, Battle Beast, Space Racer, Oliver, they all basically end up making their way toward Viltrum and then literally going after this world. Now, once they arrive there, of course, immediately there's a bit of a conflict there between Thula, one of the female Viltrumites, and then in turn, she of course warns the rest of the Viltrumites that basically, you know, these guys are coming here. And that's when like Thaddeus and that's when all the other Viltrumites basically leave the world and then immediately start coming towards these guys. Now, what you have here is this kind of ragtag bunch, right? The smaller number of guys, despite their heavy hitting capabilities, the first thing they recognize is they're too outnumbered here. They can't fight, they can't win this war in a traditional sense, right? They can't win this kind of final battle in the traditional way. Tech Jacket does show up with like a lot of these monsters that are strong enough to kill Viltrumites, and it does help to turn the tide a little bit. But at the end of the day, Thrag's here. And because Thrag's here, that's enough to turn the tide. That's enough to literally ensure that the Viltrumites will basically win. That's the crazy thing. It's because you have like these crazy displays of power. A lot of these Viltrumites are just taken out left and right, right? Alan the Alien is literally punching his hand through like one of their guts and is coming up through his mouth. And you have all these crazy things. He punches the head off of another one, and Thaddeus all just buff as hell, right? Looking like an old man who's been lifting weights for 60 years. Like he's basically, you know, facing off against these guys. And then Oliver ends up facing off against Thrag. And that's the crazy thing about it, is because when Mark initially launches an attack, not knowing who Thrag is, and basically hits him in the gut and not much happens, he kind of gets swatted away. Oliver steps in, and this fight is 2 seconds long. Literally, Thrag grabs his arm, rips it off, and punches him across space. And that's the end of Oliver. Just like that. Done. I mean, it's that fast. And people are just like, wow. You know, like, it's almost crazy to see it happen. Mark goes in for the attack, and literally, with every ounce of strength and rage, all this power that it took for him to defeat Conquest, that's what he's got here. And all he gives Thrag is a bloody nose. That's it. Right, that's all Thrag gets here. Now, the big declaration is that Thrag says that even Conquest feared him, and then Mark makes a statement and saying, well, I killed Conquest. And the funny thing is, none of the other Viltrumites knew what happened to Conquest. They didn't know what happened to him. Learning that Mark had killed him was a pretty big thing, because they're like, how in the hell did this guy kill Conquest? Like, that's crazy. Like, that's kind of nuts. But at the end of the day, they can't really do much here, right? So the only real thing that the Coalition of Worlds can do is based on a plan that Thaddeus had thought up, right? And it's desperate, and it's a last ditch effort here, but it's the only way to essentially ensure their victory in this conflict, that Thaddeus calls Space Racer to himself. Remember, he's got a weapon that can destroy virtually anything it hits, right? So he says, come with me. So ultimately, like, Space Racer fires off his gun at the Viltrum homeworld. At the same time that happens, Thaddeus, Nolan, Mark, they all basically just go racing to the core. Now, Alan the Alien and Tech Jacket are supposed to be there, but they kind of get distracted a little bit in the conflict. So it's ultimately just Thaddeus and Mark and Nolan who go racing to this world, but it's enough. They basically punch a hole through one side of the world and come out the other and literally obliterate the Viltrum homeworld. They destroy the whole thing. They obliterate the whole thing. So now the Viltrumite race has nowhere to go. While I wouldn't say this is a defeat that solidifies the victory, because all they have to do is just go to another world that has oxygen and they'll basically be fine. It's a colossal moral blow, because all that history, right? The entire existence of their race is now gone, right? It's all basically gone. And any Viltrumites that may have been on that world at the time have been destroyed with it, especially those who were caught in the blast when the planet exploded itself. So it's reduced their number by a pretty good clip. Now, ultimately, Thrag is seemingly the only one left awake here, right? The only one that's basically conscious here. And so essentially Thrag, along with maybe like 4 other guys, kind of seem to be the only ones left here. And so you end up having Thaddeus, you got Alan, you got Nolan, who are just kind of like, okay, it's over, it's done, right? Like, you will surrender, and like, that will be it. You have no empire, you have no home, you have absolutely nothing left. And the response of Thrag is, you're ridiculous if you think I'm gonna surrender. He literally races up on this guy and just rips off the head of Thaddeus in one shot. I mean, that's it, right? Thaddeus, gone. Like, his head's just ripped off in an instant. When that happens, everybody freaks. Alan the Alien, Nolan, the whole nine yards, they freak. They're like, holy shit, man. Like, this is it. Like, I mean, how are we supposed to fight against somebody like that? And like, he destroys the head of Thaddeus. Like, Battle Beast is taken out in the process. And then in turn, Thrag is just like, it's on, right? You called down the thunder. Well, now you got it, right? You guys wanted Thrag. You wanted me to get involved in this. Now I'm involved in this. You had my curiosity. Now you have my attention. The question you have to ask yourself is, when you get the attention of Freddie Mercury, the leader of the Viltrumite race, the most powerful and strongest person in creation right now, what happens when that attention gets turned to you? And let me tell you guys something, what we're going to cover in the next video, because I'm leaving y'all on a cliffhanger like hell, what happens in the next video is insane. It's absolutely insane, man. I'm saying it right now, these guys never had a chance. That's all I'm gonna leave you guys on. They never had a chance. Any chance they thought they had was an illusion. It was smoke and mirrors, right? When this guy gets done, not even in hell will you see a massacre like what you're gonna see in this next video. Anyway, guys, we're gonna bring this to an end. Thank you guys for watching, and I will catch you all later. Peace.